Oh, like right on 11. Springfield Leather Company. I am Tony Williams, and I got
Andrew.
We are trying something new with this SLC Live, live at SLC. Hopefully you guys can hear us good. Last week we had Denny make a field note journal, and he completed it for us. So we're going to give this away on Facebook through the weekend. You can go on there, share the post, comment on it, like it, whatever you want to do on there. And then we're going to collect those names together, and we're going to give this away on Monday. So that'll be kind of cool. Andrew, welcome to the video studio.
I know, right? It's my first time on camera.
Well, congratulations for that. You got a nice beard going on. We had a question when we posted stuff about your beard.
Yep.
Did you measure it this morning?
I did. I measure it every morning. This was almost big enough to measure it. I think, what are we at? Where are we?
Can I get that COVID close?
Yeah.
I can. Yeah, it's about, the ruler says if you pull it strong, it says like 13.
I'd say it's
probably closer to 26 or something like that.
I agree. Yep. That's.
Are you using this or this?
Yeah, I'll
just
use
beer
that.
Measuring?
Okay. No, I'll use that. Yeah.
So what have we got going on? Or you could use this cute one with.
Yeah, I brought that.
That
I brought that
kids?
With me. No, I've had this since grade school. That's a lie. I found this at a garage sale. So, yeah. But yeah, I'll use that one too. So I'm making a dice bag.
Or a pouch.
Or a pouch, like. But really it's a dice bag because it's what you hold your dice in. It's for Dungeons and Dragons.
Dungeons, D&D.
D&D, role playing. So.
Well, we pulled a Kevin's Exotic Scrap Bag.
Yeah.
Pull it up there. We'll have a link so you guys can see it. We just went into the box where we keep them at and pulled it out just like we would for a customer.
Yep.
We're going to patchwork something together.
I have no idea how this is going to turn out because I don't know what pieces are in here yet. But what I'm going for is something like this. It's like a kind of a Frankenstein stitched together X's patterns with the thread. I've got four different colors of thread that I'm going to use. We won't have to skive any of this down. Skiving just means making it thinner. Most of the stuff in here is pretty thin. You got some of the elephant scrap, some of the...
Why don't you open it up?
Yeah, let's open it. See what we got. We got some snake. Is that Python?
It is Python, yeah.
Python?
We have some of that in our in new items on the website. Some ostrich.
Ostrich.
That's some pretty good piece there.
Yeah. Some lizard. Some of these are big enough to make wallets out of.
Yeah.
These are pretty good
that
sizes.
One you can make a minimalist wallet out of.
Shark. Yeah.
That's a pretty good
that's
cut
what
of
I'm
shark.
Talking. That's a real good cut
and
of shark.
And black.
You can get like three. That's what the black is on that. So hopefully some of this will turn out like that.
Yeah. What else we got in there?
Elephant.
That is elephant. More lizard. That's a nice, it's like a handful of lizard.
What kind of fish is this?
That's a carp.
A carp.
Piraraku.
Piraraku.
Something like that. Don't quote me on it. I almost bought a pair of boots with that on there.
Anybody tell me what this is? Why is nobody answering?
Can't see what that is.
You know what this is? Eel.
Eel.
Eel. I might use some eel.
Yeah. All right. I'll leave you to it.
All right. So we got all sorts of stuff. I'm going to use some of the bigger pieces just because it's easier to work with. So let's get some shark. Get some of the snake. Yeah, we'll use some of the fish. And some olifant. All right. For the lining, I'm going to use this. This is a kid skin. So it's a goat. This is a taupe. Taupe Lamu, I believe, is what we sell it here in the shop for. And I'm going to use this just to make our basic pattern, and then we're going to glue the pieces down to it. The first thing that I start with is I kind of come up with a basic shape. Usually the shape on these bags are about as big as this. So we've got 5 inches by roughly 8 inches. So we'll do a 5x8 rectangle, and that's what we're going to work with on here. So I'm going to cut up a few of these pieces.
Yeah, we pulled that scrap bag out. I guess we didn't give the number. Hopefully Chad put it on there. So if you go to our website or call in 144-KSESB. Was that $10 on a scrap bag of that?
Yeah.
$10.
Yeah, that's a great deal for some of this in here. All right.
We had your uncle say hello.
My uncle said hello.
Yeah.
Well, hello, Uncle.
Michigan.
Grand Rapids. Yeah, that's Cal. He's actually the one that got me into leatherworking. Half of these tools here are from him. Yeah. This has just been a wild ride. But he is the one that got me into all this.
So are you from Michigan or did?
I am. Yeah.
You are.
I'm originally from Michigan. I was born in Grand Haven, if anybody knows where that's at, and then grew up in a little town called Jenison. It's in a suburb of Grand Rapids. All right. What I usually do with these is once I get the pieces, I just try and put them in a pattern, and I try and roughly get the dimensions that I want, and then I'm going to glue them to the sheepskin or the kid skin, and then I'm just going to start punching holes in it. So once we get the general shapes and pieces that we want, we'll put them together like a puzzle. So, what do I do with my scissors?
How long have you been doing leather crafting?
About 15 years, roughly. My uncle, I think it was about 10 years ago when he actually gave me the tools. I had been working with the stuff before that, but I hadn't really delved too deeply into it. Enjoyed it. I would make bags and just little pouches and things like that, but nothing spectacular. He gave me a set of tools, just some stamping tools, some scissors, some granite slabs, a poundo board, just the basics that I needed, and then sat down with me, and over a couple days when he came to visit, he taught me how to use them all.
Use some of that ostrich for the bottom.
Yeah. Ostrich is nice stuff. It's very soft. What do they call that? Quill?
Yeah. Mm. Where the quills are in it.
What do they mainly use ostrich for?
Boots. See a lot of boots made out of ostrich. Even some of that scrap bag, if you took and you got some of those... I know Larissa's put together a belt out of ostrich and just lined the back of it with a Herman Oak on there.
Okay. Get some of this eel in here. When we're putting the pieces together and gluing them onto the lining, you kind of want to be cognizant of how many stitch lines you're going to have. I get too many of this and get too many small pieces, and I'm just going to be stitching for hours and hours. So I try and use bigger pieces, and this might at least get us one panel. So let's roll with this.
Yeah, if we don't have enough time to make it all through, we'll do what we did with Denny's Field Note and finish it up and show the after product.
That's a great idea. Use my big ruler. Use a razor blade usually to cut this stuff, just to get a straight line. And I'll take the piece that I want. I'll cut a similar straight line. And just mash them up like that.
So is everybody good with this view, or I can move it in closer? See if we can't get a comment if they want to see a little bit closer. Yeah. I got some lining there as well, so I think that's going to be the inside of the bag.
It's going to be the inside of the bag. I'm going to glue it to the rough side. Glue all these scraps to the rough side so that on the inside of the bag you have a nice finished look as well. So.
So what do you do with your leather work now? I know a lot of people start like a small little business, little side gig. We have lots of people here that have side gigs.
I've got a side hustle. Grimbeardleather.com is where I sell my stuff. I make a lot of nerd things, so wallets and
nerd wallets,
field notebooks, and nerd wallets. There you go.
I think that's actually a website.
Is it really?
It's free promotion.
That's right. I'm gonna do 6 inches across the top. It'll give us a little playroom here.
All right. So they want to see closer, so I'm going to move it to a little side camera here so we can see along.
Okay. It's that whole measure twice, cut once thing. Probably should have measured it before I actually cut the piece instead of just eyeballing it.
So. You don't have a leather stretcher?
I do not. They're sold with the board stretchers next to the blinker fluid at the hardware store. All right, there's a 7. And I'm using a silver marking pen. If you've never used a marking pen before, they're pretty awesome. It'll come off of most leather. Suede, it's a little rougher to get off of. But on the finish side, you can actually mark the where you're drawing your lines and then just take some water or one of the leather erasers and it'll come right off.
Yeah. So we move to the side view here. We'll see what we can see out of it. We have some things in the work. This live, I think we're, what, 4 videos into this? Kind of a new venture for us. So we have a switcher coming in that'll hook to my computer that'll allow us to hook up 4 cameras to it so we can get that overhead shot. Right now I don't have a video input to where I can get that. So I tried to handhold it last week and it was a little shaky.
What I'm doing right now is I'm going across. I'm just measuring out the basic square, and I'm going to cut 2 of these so we can start gluing the pieces down onto it. I'm doing a little bit larger than I actually want to make the dice bag. I'm doing 7 by 9 inches, and I actually want this to be about 6 by 8. The overlap will just cut off. But that way we can glue the scraps over top of the leather, and we don't have to worry about being exact with it. It's a lot easier just to measure just a little bit more than you need.
I'm going to try to rig something up so we can get a little more overhead here while you work, Andrew.
Okay. Usually I'd lay a straight edge on this to cut it just so that I get a perfect line, but like I said, we're making this a little bit bigger, so I don't mind if the lines are not perfection on the edges. There's one piece. And this I can roughly go over with the piece I've already created. If you're going to be doing a bunch of these, it doesn't hurt to make a template. You can just do it out of a piece of cardboard.
Move a tripod and let it get on the way here.
How many people we got in the chat now?
32.
32 people.
How many people do you have in your family?
I have
32.
So what's everybody else working on? Like, anybody, throw a message in the chat. Happy to answer some questions.
What do you do here, Andrew?
I work in the e-commerce department. I do mainly the online sales for eBay, Etsy, Amazon, that type of thing. And then in my free time, I work on leather. But actually working for Springfield Leather, I do e-commerce stuff, creating listings and shipping orders and packaging things. And
I'm going to try to move the camera here again.
All right. Let me know when it's back on.
Let's see. All right. Go ahead, Chad.
Yeah, that looks a lot better.
All right. I'm going to go with one panel at a time. If you notice, some of these are curved. You've got some edges on there. And a lot of time I like to preserve that type of thing instead of just going with really straight pieces. So you've got some curves going around along here. You've got a natural curve in the leather right here and over here. It's easier to stitch on straight or big curves, but to get around stuff like this, like if I want to attach these two pieces together, what I do is just lay it over top of where I want it to be, and then I'll run my marking pen over the curve itself. And that's
so
where
so
I cut.
Just so you know, Andrew, we're right about just that whole white poly there.
Yeah.
Right. So we had some questions here. Making this bag, how many D20 dies? D20s would fit in this bag. This is a language I don't know.
How many D20s? I've got three of them right here. Let's roll for damage. Well, I rolled a natural 20, so you should be able to fill at least 20 in this bag. At least.
So I get D20s. That's a kind of dice?
Yeah, D20. It's has to do with the sides, the number of sides on the dice. So six-sided dice would be a D6. D10 would be a 10-sided dice.
I thought D10 was like a plane.
It might be.
Okay.
I know nothing about planes. Do we have any scotch tape? I think that's the only thing that I forgot.
Well, I have some packing tape.
Oh, that works. Something I can...
Or I have some basting tape.
Basting tape would not work for this.
Especially when it's the 1/8-inch basting tape.
Yeah, that's tiny stuff, but man, is it great. That's what I primarily use now for before I start stitching things is the 1/8-inch.
So projects, we had some wallets. Hats. Bags. Have you made... I know Grimbeard thing. Have you made a hat?
I have. Yes.
Yeah? You should have worn it.
I should have worn my hat. I have a... when I started out, I did a lot of steampunk type stuff. So top hats were kind of the thing that I made for the most part. And that's what taught me how to do leather work. So I was making a lot of top hats. I actually made my uncle that's watching right now, I made him a kind of a Mad Hatter style top hat with some steampunk goggles on the top. And it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it.
Did we do a steampunk thing for you over at Laser Patterns? I don't remember. We did one for this.
Yeah. You guys made me a pattern before I started working here. You guys made me a pattern for a mask, a plague doctor mask.
Yeah. And then you just decided to come in and join the fun.
I did. I begged to come and join the fun. It's a true story.
Yeah. So your uncle got you in the leather crafting. 15 years. What's the biggest project that you've had?
The biggest project that I've had... You know, that's a good question. It's probably the one that I've got going on right now.
A dice bag. On a live video?
On a live video. That's not what I'm talking about. Oh, okay. But, I mean, we could roll with that. I partnered up with a small business called Silver Wing Armory. They're out of Canada. Mm-hmm. And they make some really great campaign journals or campaign notebooks for role-playing and Dungeons & Dragons, that type of thing. And they wanted some leather covers, so I hit him up and I was like, hey, I can make leather covers for you. Let's try and do this. So in the holiday season, we're trying to gear up for the holiday season, and we're going to try and make 100 of them if we can. It's a pretty tall order, so I think we can fill it. So that's probably the biggest project that I've ever had.
Yeah, I went over and took a peek at the chat, and everybody says that I'm lost with Dungeons & Dragons.
I'm lost with Dungeons & Dragons.
No, I am, which is a fair assessment.
Yeah. You've never played before.
No, I have never played before.
Would you like to play now?
We're in the process of making a pouch that fits 20 die.
I will take that as a polite no, sir. I will not want to play right now.
So, Andrew?
Yes?
When doing patchwork like this, is it important to use pieces that are the same thickness?
In this particular project, no. I don't really worry about that. I If it gets way too thick, like the shark skin versus the lizard skin, I don't know if you can see it on the camera, but it's significantly, probably 2 to 3 times as thick as this. When we're stitching it together, because we're covering it up with this type of stitching, it's not really gonna matter that much. When you're making other types of things, yeah, it probably makes a difference, probably matters. The tape that I'm using on the back is just holding these pieces together. Everywhere that this connects, we're gonna have to stitch across. So that's why I mentioned doing larger pieces would probably be of more benefit to you in doing straighter lines. So cut a little bit of this off.
So I see you kind of tape it together and then you make you a straight line and then trace your pattern back over to the next piece and
yep.
Cut its shape out.
Exactly. And once we've got all the pieces done for one panel, and I'm going to focus on doing one panel and then I'll probably finish the rest off off screen because I think we'll run out of time. Let's see, we're getting close here.
We've only been going for about 20 minutes.
No, that's not bad. So just outside of the bag, so I've got to fill up the rest of this area right here. So we'll do a nice big piece of this. That'll fill up some area.
Now that you were saying you're rolling for the damage, so is that what the D stands for in the D20?
D stands for die.
Well, that was my next guess.
Was it? Okay. All right. I'll give it to you.
I see patchwork is kind of your gig that you got going on.
I love it. I think it's a lot of fun.
I don't know if they can see. Let me put that there for a second. Holding all your needles.
Yeah, I made that as like a bracelet so that while I was stitching and stuff, I could just hold it on.
So you can still roll the die?
So I can still roll the die, yeah.
You can't see it there.
All right. There we go. That's better. Patchwork is fun for me because I can use a lot of different things in it, and I don't know, it always turns out unique. It's always something completely different than what I created last time. I'm also not too worried. You may see a little bit of gap in there. Not really worried about that at the moment. When we do the stitching, it's going to pull this stuff tight, and it's going to cover those gaps up. Plus, we have a lining in the back, so that'll help as well.
So we paid $10 for this scrap bag. Well, we didn't, but that's the price.
It cost $10.
So. Yeah. We'll tell Rusty. We'll put on Rusty's bill later.
That's right.
What would you sell a bag like this for? On your website, grimbeard.com.
A hand-stitched patchwork bag I would probably sell in the $80 to $100 range.
So there you go. $10 for the bag, then the skill to put it together.
The skill to put it together. So, and the time it takes to do the stitching. The stitching is a big part of it, and it does take quite a bit of time.
All right. You want some fish in there?
Yeah, let's throw some fish in there. Almost. Almost got that fish in there. All right. This one I'm going to do on the back because it has a weird pattern. So.
Did you put some ostrich in there yet?
No, I haven't. I've got a piece. I can put that down in the corner. This is very fuzzy stuff on the back, so this will hold the glue really well.
Yeah, we're going to be using some Renia glue.
Yeah.
So Renia Aqualem 315, which is a water-based glue. I remember when we were talking, setting this up, you like water-based glue.
I do. I prefer it because I work out of my garage, and using the like barge cement and stuff like that, it gets
potent?
It's very potent. So very, very potent.
And with that, if nobody's used that Renia, the Aqualem 315 before, it doesn't really have a smell to it. But man, it is super sticky. Have you used it before?
Oh, yeah.
I love it.
I've gone through half a bottle of that doing this type of thing, doing patchwork. It's what I used on this journal to line the inside. I mean, this is lined so that it covers up all this crazy stitching. It's just lined with a pigskin.
Yeah, we get it out of Germany.
But yeah, that stuff is great. It's amazing. All right. Need some more tape. If I can find the end. Yeah, I did. There we go.
So what else do you do besides leather work and e-commerce work?
Well, those are my two big ones. My hobby is leather, but it's also my passion. I really enjoy doing it. As far as other hobbies, I build. You're gonna know a lot about this actually.
We'll see.
I build the three-dimensional dungeons for role playing games, like Dungeons and Dragons.
Oh yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about.
Yep. See, I knew you would.
I'm not so lost anymore.
That is a hobby that I don't try to profit from because it's very time intensive. Give me a second. I got leather dust in my throat. All right. I use molds, like silicone molds, and then I pour plaster into the molds, and it creates little bricks, kind of like Legos.
Uh-huh.
And those Legos, I just piece together with glue, and then I build castles and dungeons and villages and all sorts of things. It's fun. It's enjoyable.
So like model train sets, except for
it's cool. Yeah. It's
except for it's cool.
So that's my other hobby.
Yeah, we were talking about another one of my friends that plays other games. Was that Star Wars we were talking about? X-Wing.
Oh, yeah, X-Wing. Yep. Yeah, I like board games. Board games are great. There we go.
They roll dice in that game.
They do.
Yeah.
They'll roll a lot of dice.
See, I'm not
in that
so
game.
Lost.
There's another option with this, too. I like to cut right up to the edges for most of this, but we can leave an overlap on it. So I'm trying to fill in this gap. Instead of cutting this to the piece, we can just do this because we're going to be gluing it. We're going to be stitching over this, and this will completely fill in the gaps over here. So I'm going to leave this piece like that.
Yeah, plus that fish is laying up on that thin lizard.
Yeah, yep. So.
What would you say the cost is of all the tools that you're using to do a project like this?
The cost of all the tools, specifically for this project, probably right around 100 if you included the like Poundo board. You're including the mallets, includes these. So probably right around 100 bucks.
Just go in the
roughly.
Kitchen and get your cutting board, poly cutting board.
Exactly.
You can use that.
Totally.
Pair of scissors, a utility knife.
Yeah.
Punches and needles and thread.
Yeah. We're not too too concerned about the back of this because it's
gonna be lined.
It's gonna be lined. We're gluing over it. So once we get done with the stitching, we're actually gonna take all this tape off and just tear it off and glue right over top of it. So almost there.
Good way to cut yourself.
I know.
There you go. Cut
yourself. Toward myself. There we go. All right. Kids, don't do this at home. Well, this part. We can do the rest of this at home.
Might be a good project, get one of these scrap bags. We have other scrap bags and stuff like that.
Yeah, there's...
Kids make some projects.
Lizard? I think we've got a lizard scrap bag. What else do we have? We've got a ton. Upholstery scrap. It's...
Veg scrap to learn how to do some tooling.
But, I mean, the amount that I've used just for this one panel, I honestly could probably do four or five bags out of this. It's crazy.
Slide the rest of it over.
Yeah.
I mean, look. Oh, there you go.
This is nuts.
I mean, there's still quite and some shark in there. Some big pieces.
Yeah.
Still big pieces of ostrich and shark in there. Don't lose your...
So you pay 10 bucks for a bag like this, and you grab some of the elephant and some of the shark, and you make a couple wallets, and you sell your wallets, you've more than paid for it.
Make a minimalist wallet out of elephant?
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy. I've got a few on my website. I think I'm selling for 30, 25 or 30 just for a little minimalist wallet. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. Yep.
And that's a steal even at that price.
It is. Yeah.
You see some of those online, they're $80, $100 plus for an elephant minimalist wallet.
All right. We've got our basic bag shape for one of the side panels. So
is there any leathers that you wouldn't put next to each other for any reason?
Me personally, no. I guess if we're talking about like a veg tan versus upholstery leather, I'd maybe not put those two together just because I don't like the look of it and the way that they stitch together. But for this type of thing, yeah, I think the crazier the better. I like the looks of them. So. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to match the panel on the back I don't want to start stitching yet because I don't want to stitch all the way up here and waste all this time stitching through this when it's just going to be cut off. So at this point, I'm going to lay this on here and do a rough cut and get rid of the excess.
Did you go some way to the scrap pad already?
And if you've got one of these boards, I've always found instead of actually turning your leather project, just turn the board. It keeps it flat and keeps your lining from
moving around.
Yep. And coming off, and then you cut the wrong spot. I've had several people ask me how to cut straight lines with a ruler and keep it from moving. It's a pain in the neck. So if you have a weight or something that you can put on one end of it and then lay your ruler down, it makes life a lot easier. Yeah, 2 pound anvil. That'll
anvil,
work.
We have those dead weights that Denny uses for tooling.
Oh yeah, yep, those would work great.
With lead shot, make you a leather bag and fill it full of lead shot.
Yep. This fish is tough to get through sometimes.
It's probably tough to catch.
Yeah, probably is. Probably why it makes such good leather is because it has a tough skin. Because you probably couldn't do that with a common salmon. All right, one more cut. Two more cuts. See, I did it right there. I just shifted the whole piece. But that's okay, because we're a little bit larger than we want to be. Okay. So we've got our basic shape. Don't want to start gluing yet, because we want the inside of this bag to look nice, and we don't want our stitching popping through it. So we'll set that off to the side. And here's where we start punching our holes.
So I'll do a couple punches here, and then I'll switch to a different camera angle because it's just going to shake the camera.
Sure. So these punches we sell here at Springfield Leather, they're the primary ones that I use and when I'm doing this type of punching. I am not concerned about doing a perfect line across here. If you'll notice when I did the stitching on this, some of the holes will come up to here. They bounce way off the edge. It's so that I can do these big things and make the gaps come out. So some of the holes are actually deep into the leather. And to me, it gives it that more Frankenstein-like messy, grungy look that I really like. I really dig it.
Still so, kind of that steampunk look.
Yeah, yeah, yep, exactly. We're not going to go straight up to the edge because this is going to be our stitching line. So if you figure this part, this end, and then this part right here is where we're going to run our stitches. So, and it looks like we lost a little bit of scrap over here. That's all right. So I'm going to start punching here.
So if you haven't punched holes, so you're going to, you punched your holes. Did you line up mm-hmm. in the last hole of it?
I do. To keep the spacing the same? Stick that last iron right there in the last hole, and it keeps your stitching straight. That's important when you're doing wallets and stuff, and when you're wanting to get a completely straight line. So, you want me to keep punching while you're setting that up?
Yeah, I'm just going to get this tripod set up so we can get high.
I also like to count how many holes that I'm going if I'm doing a project like a wallet. So if I'm punching using this this tool, I go one, put it in the last hole, two, put it in the last one, and three. That will give me the exact amount of holes on both sides that I'm stitching on. I don't have to go back and count them manually. Not important on this project. I actually want the holes to be off so that we get some really cool patterns. So I'm going to go a little bit outside on this one. We're back.
Now we're not wiggling around everywhere. Maybe forceful in the sound, though.
There we go. All right. So just going to go around and punch a bunch of holes here, and then I'm going to grab the thread out, and I'm going to do some stitching before I punch all the rest of them just to show you. If you're not wanting to do quite as many of these holes, you can use the smaller one. It comes with a 6, a 4, and a 2. The reason they don't have 1 on this, and I wondered this when I first bought them, is because you always want to go in that last hole to get a straight line. And that's why they give you 2 instead of just 1, because it'll be off if you don't.
So. Will you give us your website one more time? Maybe yeah. Chad can put it in the chat there.
It's grimbeardleather.com.
So GRIMBEARD .com.
.com.
Grimbeardleather.com. Where'd that name come from?
That was a culmination of hours and hours of my wife and I writing down words and phrases and things that I wanted to encompass.
Was it the first name of your company?
No. First one was Clockwork Leather Co., which I still use every once in a while. We wrote down a bunch of different things that we liked the sound of. And
so from your website, can everybody get to your socials?
Yeah, absolutely. Yep, it's at Grimbeard Leather on Instagram. I think it's the same on Facebook.
There should be links to it though on your website.
Yeah, everything's there at the website. So.
What makes a website nice?
What makes a website nice?
No, I was saying that's what makes a website nice. Is that you can just send them to grimbeard.com and then get to the rest of it.
Grimbeardleather.com.
Grimbeardleather.
Yeah, I think grimbeard.com is like a children's book, believe it or not. I think. It's something about a dwarf. See Stacy laughing in the background.
Does that go with the dice game?
No, it doesn't. I think it's legitimately a children's book. Yeah. All right, so I've got 4 different kinds of thread. These are wax threads that we sell here at Springfield Leather. I like to go crazy with the colors, and I want the thread to pop. So on something like this, if I go with a black, it's going to kind of blend into the fish, and I don't want it to blend in with the fish. So I would either use a white or a tan. I'm going to use a white just because it'll probably show up better on the camera. When I'm stitching this, you can use 2 needles and do like a saddle stitch type thing. I only use 1. And I'll show you why here in just a second. What I do is I go along my holes with the string, and I measure out approximately how long I'm going to need one piece of string to go through that. And then I take 6 times as much thread that I need. And this will account for the bigger stitches, the bigger knots, some of the decorative stuff that I want to do. And we're not really concerned about getting this exact. I just want to get it to the point, like if I stop and I can only get halfway through this because I did a big decorative knot over here, it's totally okay because we're going to switch out threads and we're going to do different colors through here.
So we had a question from Pipehead Oregon, I assume, and he's asking about a stitching method, so I'm going to say it wrong.
All right.
But it's like Chippy Choquin, Choquin.
The Choquin method? Yeah.
So I didn't, did I say it right then?
Yeah, yeah.
Was it some silly dice game?
Yeah, it's a weird dice game. Like, I can't get into it. It's so secretive. The Choquin stitching method is just... It's just nuts.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just nuts. I would need hours to go into that.
Yeah. Well, there you go. There's your answer, Pipehead.
All right. So the very first knot right there is going to be on the edge of our dice bag, and more than likely, it's going to get stitched through or very close to it. So we're not concerned about the look of that. I'm just going to tie a knot on the back.
Grimbeard is a video game. We have been made aware of.
Grimbeard is a video game. There is a reviewer that does reviews on YouTube, I think, of video games. I don't know. So, all right. Trim that off. Now we're just going to start stitching. I like to do X patterns when I'm stitching. So just come through the back, and I'll skip a hole on this side, and I'll go down 1. And then I'm going to come through that hole that I skipped from the back and then over the top, just like a shoelace. And it makes an X. And I just do that a few times. Getting into the more decorative stitching on here is pretty much the same type of thing that I'm doing right here. So once I'm going to do one more, and then we'll do a big decorative knot. I don't want to pull this too tight, because if I pull it too tight, it's just going to squeeze the leather in like that, and it'll end up being bunchy and bulky. And so I leave it very, very loose. This isn't so much holding the bag together. It is holding the bag together once we take the tape off, but the glue is pretty much going to hold it in place. All right, so I've got three of the X's there. I'm going to come through this hole, and I'm going to skip all the way down to here. And it doesn't matter what hole you come out of on the bottom. You're basically just doing a gigantic X. And I'm going to come through here. And this is why we need so much thread, because we're already having to adjust the needle because we're running out of thread. I'm going to come across the bottom right here and create just a normal flat stitch. And then on the back, I'm going to come all the way back up to the top, right by the first hole that I created, and do the same thing over here. And if you haven't figured it out yet, this is not a clean stitch by any means. This is a very rough and dirty, just thrown together. I love it. So we're going to just make great big X's all the way down. Across to the other side. And this is really where the majority of the time in this method of stitching is just sitting on your couch, listening to some music, watching TV, and throwing a few hours into a bag like this. This entire bag will probably take a couple hours to stitch together.
So did you see somebody come do this before, or is this something that you just came up with?
Yeah, this is just something that I came up with. I started doing it on my hats. I'm sure it's been done before, but I haven't seen it. I just, when I did my hats, I would use scrap leather from here. I would buy it out of the by pound bin because it's all I could afford at the time. And yeah, there's some amazing leather in that scrap bin. I still use it. I would go in there and it had big scars in it. Things that you would cut off a pre-cut piece if you were using for a really nice panel on a bag or something. And instead of throwing it away, they throw it in a bin and they sell it by the pound. And so I grabbed those pieces and I didn't really know at first what to do with the flaws in them. So I started using those flaws to my advantage. I would take a huge scar that would be running through a piece of leather. For example, with this. So I've got a scar right there. It was in the shark.
Yeah.
And I just stitched across it. So it kind of
humanizes it.
Yeah. Yeah, almost. This right here is, I believe that's actually where the shark eye was. And I just took a little
put his eye back.
Yeah, I just put a little plastic doll eye in there. I glued it to the back, and then I used some of the Toka Pro on the edges right there. Just to give it a not so rough look on the end. And then just popped it through. And it's the same down here. I had a couple holes right there, so I just put some stitching over that and popped an eye through right there. So I guess using the stuff that...
Using the imperfections to your advantage?
I love it. I absolutely love it. So, getting down to the last stitch in the center here. So I've got two holes left, and it might be hard to see. There's one here and one here.
Let's see if I can zoom in a little bit.
So right in the center. So what we're doing is we're creating a pattern that comes across. I'm going to come through this hole and go into this hole, but once I come out of this, I want to create kind of a loop or a knot in the center. So I'm going to go under my thread, try and get to the other side, bring it underneath it, and I'm going to do this a couple times. And it tightens it up in the center. And then I'm going to go through that last hole over here.
Just kind of holding your X together so it doesn't
flail
out everywhere.
Yep. So once that's done, I have a couple options. Usually I'm gonna flatten this out, so I'll just take my hammer and I flatten it out. And then I'll come back, because it's a wax thread, I can melt it. You can melt it with a lighter, and it soaks all that wax into the thread and gives it kind of a cleaner look. And it makes the thread itself pop. This is a bonded nylon thread, so it it can hold up to the heat. You don't want to get too close to it because it will burn. It's thread. On the back, here's what it looks like on the back and why we can remove the, we could remove the tape in this section right now. You can either come down here and continue stitching, or you can change up thread colors if you want. I'm just going to keep stitching because I've got the extra thread and I don't want to throw it away. You can do straight over instead of the X's. It's kind of like the sky's the limit on this. Whatever you think looks good, just roll with it. That's kind of what makes it fun. The Frankenstein stitch. That's what my wife calls it.
From Dan Baldwin.
Dan Baldwin.
Yeah, he hangs out on our live videos quite a bit. He's
oh, cool.
Yeah, we see him quite a bit through there. He asked for the website name, and then Chad gave him our website. He's like, I got that one down. How about the Ruby?
I got that
site?
One down. Huh? Yeah, I love making stuff like this. It just, I've taken all the things that that I grew up with that I'm, I guess, passionate about. I mean, cheesy 80s movies, nerd stuff, Indiana Jones, Back to the Future, X-Files. I mean, you name it. All the stuff that I really enjoyed as a kid. I'm like, what can I do with that in the leather world? Not a lot of people doing it. There's some people doing it. But I don't know, just to make something unique for folks to, hopefully purchase one day. So.
What are you listening to when you leather craft, Andy?
I listen to all sorts of stuff. Like you've been over to my garage, so it's mostly upbeat, happy music. I listen to pop music. I listen to bluegrass. I listen to sometimes I get into metal music. Can't really get into that too much. I don't know. I don't enjoy it that much. But Irish pub songs. I really like Irish pub songs.
Barbershop quartets.
Sometimes, yeah. Yep. My uncle is. Mostly to blame for my eclectic music style. Bela Fleck.
I saw him in concert here.
Did you really?
Yeah.
He's been to Springfield a few times, and I wanted to see him. I like Bela Fleck. I like banjo music. All sorts of stuff. Just whatever floats my boat at that time is what I'm listening to. And here's where I need the two.
Yeah, Victor Wooten and his brother.
Oh, yeah. He is one heck of a bass player.
Yeah.
All right. So I've got a little bit of thread left, and I am at a kind of an intersection with four pieces of leather. And we've got some gaps there. I was kind of talking about that earlier. To get rid of the gaps, I just start stitching over top of them, and I go crazy. So there's going to be, like, a huge knot here if I don't run out of thread. Doesn't matter what holes you go in and out of, but you're going to run out of thread real quick doing this. But this will cover up the gaps, and only a little bit of the lining will actually show through when you're done. All right, I'm going to finish this up, and then we will wrap it up, and then I'll finish this off camera.
Yeah.
And then we're going to do a giveaway with this, too, next week.
So. Yeah, we'll just talk. Why don't we, after we get this little spot of how to join four pieces together, and then they can kind of make up their stitches as we go through.
Yeah.
Talk about how we finish up the top and how we finish up the bottom.
Sure. All right.
Because I assume putting a liner in there is gluing it, and then it fits together when you stitch the rest of the bag together.
Yep. Here I said not to pull too hard. You can pull just a little bit just to join that together. And then usually I'll come right back through that hole that I stitched. And because this is wax thread, it catches on itself. And it'll snug those two pieces up. So we've all but lost that gap right there in the center. So that's basically what you're going to do. And then you'll just continue doing the same type of stuff all through all of your seams. And switch up the thread. Make it look cool. I'm going to trim this off of here.
You sharpen your scissors.
I know, I do. I use them all day long.
So you said you pull off the tape on the back after you get everything stitched together?
I do.
Yep.
So in this particular section, you can pull the tape off. It's not going to come off easy where you stitched because you stitched through it. But like I said, it doesn't really matter. You don't need to get all of it off. Just the parts that...
The majority.
Yeah, just the majority of it because we're going to lay some glue on that. And let's trim down that a little bit. But anyhow, you get the idea. So cut the tape off the back, and then next step is to glue it. So I would take the Renia, the Aquilium, and we've got some in here. I'm not going to use it yet because I'm not done stitching. And you put it all over the back of this. This is a little silicone brush that Tony was showing me. I'd actually never used one of these before. So I usually use a foam brush because they're cheap. I can get them at the dollar store, but I guess these work really well. So you spread your glue out. You spread it out until you have it flat, even surface. Stick this off to the side. Do the same on this one. And when you're ready to join these together, I always put my lining on the bottom because this one is really bumpy. If you have this on the bottom and you're trying to put the lining on top of it when it glues together, it's going to catch. You're going to have bubbles and but anyhow, that's just what I do for that. Usually I'll start at the top. I will line it up like this. I'll get it to stick just a little bit, and I'll lay my hand on it, and I'll flip it back like this, and I will slowly roll it towards me, just ever so slowly. Because we created this a little bit bigger, our stitch line, when we're done gluing this whole thing, we're going to have a stitch line all the way around here. Once it's done gluing, we're going to cut it again. That's why you don't want to come all the way up to your edge with the stitch. So once you get to about here, just stop your stitch about here.
So you're going to glue it. You're going to glue it together, and then you'll cut through the lining and the patchwork part of it together.
Yep.
Then you have a nice even edge.
Yep. Something I didn't mention for the top, how this is actually going to join together. Always use a soft leather at the top. Like, I'm not going to have this be the top of the bag. This will be the bottom of the bag. We want this to cinch together. So once this is done and glued, I'm going to punch 6 holes in the top using my hole punch. So I use the biggest one right here, and I will just come across and I'll evenly punch 6 holes into it right there. You can put eyelets in it if you want, just those.
Here, hold that. Hang.
Yeah.
Let me move the camera up just a little bit.
Sure.
So do it right down on top of the pie there. So the soft, right, soft at the top there.
Soft at the top. Yep. And I'm gonna punch 6 holes in here, and the reason I do 6 holes is because of the way the tie will go through it. You want the tie to lay. To actually come out the last hole and have the end of it sticking up like this. So it's basically, it's an even number of holes is what you're going for. You're going to do 2 pieces of thread or 2 pieces of the string. I'd always use a super strong leather stuff. Don't use suede for this. You're going to cinch it together. It's just going to snap on you. Yeah.
Or stretch.
Exactly. Yep. So you'll get a piece when it's open. I'm going to go about that big, and I want to bring it right to the end just to where I have enough to do a knot. And I'll show you what I mean here. So we have our holes punched, and we just kind of weave them in and out and in and out. It's going to come around this part, and it's going to come out that end. Then you're going to tie a knot. Once it's stitched through there, you're just going to tie a knot in the end of this, so you need just a little bit. That way, when you draw it together, you're going to have quite a bit of overlap. And that's pretty much all there is to it. I'll get this finished up and hopefully we can give it away.
Yeah, let me working a little bit. Let me
okay, sure.
Move this camera so we can finish
this. Switch threads. But this is kind of a finished one. I don't know if you can see it from there. This is a different style of
bring
bag.
To the middle.
Yeah, I'll take it off my...
Or just bring your bag over there.
Yeah, you can do that too. There we go. I've got it tied to the outside bag. So this is what I'm talking about with the opening. This I just used some sewing machine thread, but this is how it will cinch up to the top, and that's why you want your laces to come out with just enough room for a knot. So, but that's the basic idea. This uses 4 panels on this particular one instead of 2. The 2 is just the easier method and what I usually use for the dice pouches, but yeah. That's pretty much all there is to it.
I'm going to switch to black.
All right.
All right. Well, we'll let you finish up on that. Plus, you got to probably get back to e-com and sell some stuff.
Yeah, probably. That might not be a bad idea, huh?
Yeah. We appreciate everybody joining us for this live at SLC. Let us know what you guys want to see kind of next. If you like Rusty and Kevin up here, we're going to get them back next week and have them talk about the leather world, where leather comes from, where we source some leather, how it's sourced, stuff like that.
That'd be good information.
Yeah.
how we sell it, splitting, some stuff on our website and how you can better order things on there and leave your customer notes. But yeah, look out on Facebook, Instagram for a post about this field note journal that we did last week.
That's sharp. That looks really good.
Yeah, and then the inside, nice and clean.
Yep.
So keep a lookout for that. Like and share it, and then we will give it away on Monday. Thanks for joining us.
Cool. Thanks.